Hi everyone. Before we begin, I want you to think about the most recent app that you wrote, that you developed. Now, I want you to think also about the time that you were sick and you needed to take drugs. And now I want you to think about the last time you used some unsustainable material, like driving your car this morning or sitting on a plastic chair. So, what if your next app can actually fix these issues and make our planet more sustainable? I'm Yogev Debbi. I'm the general manager of the Israel R&D Center at Twist Bioscience. And what we do, we make DNA. We synthesize genes from scratch. And think about a 3D printer, which instead of the product being plastic or silicone, it is actually molecules of DNA, molecules of genes. We synthesize them, we put it in a tube, and ship it to the customer in a FedEx envelope. This is used mainly for genetic engineering, and we'll go over some examples later on. So our customers, basically what they do, they send us sequences of DNA, A, T, G, and C, and we make it for them. How does it look like? Did anyone have experience writing assembly code? Yeah, how fun is this? So, this is even worse. This is the binary level of life. This is the ones and zeros, A, T, G, and C. By the way, it's obscure because my lawyers asked me, this is a real file from customer, so they asked me to obscure it. What you see here are three genes. Each gene, think about it as a function in your code, but everything is ones and zeros. Everything is A, T, G, and C. So this poor scientist, in order to differentiate between segments in his gene, he used sophisticated and advanced features of Word, bold, italic, underline, etc. So that's not scalable if you're talking about hundreds of functions. We have thousands of genes in a genome, in human genome, thousands of genes. So when you want to do something sophisticated, it's really hard to write in ones and zeros. That's why in the Tel Aviv center of Twist, we are the software R&D center, and we write the IDE, the framework for DNA. Think about it as the Visual Studio, or IntelliJ, Eclipse, PyLab, you name it, for DNA. How does it look like? This is just a snapshot. So you can still see the DNA letter because that's the language that we talk in science, but you see some metadata, annotations, and abstraction layers, and the most nice thing is that when you're done designing and debugging and compiling, you actually put your genes in the shopping cart, add your credit card, and send it to synthesis. And the manufacturing facility, which is in San Francisco, will make it for you and send it to your lab in a tube. So let's go over some examples. So first example is from the healthcare industry. There is a company in San Diego, and what they do with genetic engineering and this advanced synthetic genes technology, which is called synthetic biology, they create a genetically modified pig generation so you can actually take organs from the pig and transplant it into humans. So in a few years, we'll actually have a human organs bank. Another example is the enzyme CRISPR. This is the most advanced and most recent advancement in healthcare. Think about it as a nanorobot made out of DNA, which can go through your genome and change it in runtime. Now, think about changing in runtime your code after it is deployed in production. This is basically the case here. You can program this little enzyme, and it can actually change your genome. It can do it in any location, any index in your genome. So human genome is 6 billion letters of code. So now we have random access ability to change it, just like an array. So you see the notation here. I can see my genome as an array, just change it. What do we need this for? So this opened the door for fixing genetic diseases, cure cancer. And all of these companies are already doing it. And there are also companies working on increasing longevity, increase the life expectancy. So these are all our customers. Another example, I don't know if you had dessert, this lunch, but who doesn't like chocolate, right? So we all eat chocolate, but I don't know how many of you know, the cocoa trees that you make chocolate out of, they're actually being cut down and they're decreasing. And there's just so many areas around the globe that we can grow the cocoa trees. And soon enough, with the growing population in the world, we won't have enough chocolate. So there is a company that took algae, azote, and actually genetic engineered them in order to create the cocoa butter which you make the chocolate out of. And if you're here tomorrow, by the way, there is a little surprise in our booth. The same, you have synthetic food, almost everything from milk without cows, eggs without chicken, and even meat without animals at all. And by the way, for the guys that just entered, we're still talking about code and Python. And just to give you a small notation of why DNA is so complex and these companies are just being just starting to grow, DNA is a complex code, and you know that we don't know the entire DNA on Earth yet, and most of the work for scientists today is to try to analyze and reverse engineer the code. Now, one of the interesting notations is what you think about it, DNA is double helix. So you can basically read it from left to right and right to left, and the program counter in biology called DNA polymerase. And the DNA polymerase it goes on the DNA, and he reads same sequence, same gene, or piece of gene. When he reads it from left to right, it does one thing. When he reads it from right to left, it does totally different thing in the same code. Now, I don't know if you try to reverse engineer binary code, but how complicated is this? Think about program counter, instead of just going from zero address down, it also go up. And by the way, some organisms even doesn't have address zero. They are circular, so there is no start and end. And functions are read according to environmental conditions, like temperature, existence of other chemicals, etc. This is crazy. So another example, spider silk. Spider silk is the strongest material on Earth, and we would want to create more of that. But you cannot farm spiders, because they will eat each other in nature. So that doesn't work. So there's a company, they took yeast, shmarim, and they genetically engineered yeast to produce the spider silk. Now, I don't know if you drank beer at lunch, but now imagine this. These guys, they have a facility for yeast. It's a brewery, just like beer, only instead of beer, it produces the material which you make the spider silk from. And the last example I wanted to discuss is also about data. So in this conference, we're talking a lot about data, data science and data analysis and big data and all of that. So guys, where do you store all of this data? SSD, flash drives, magnetic tapes? Well, it's all gonna evaporate in a few years. That's why we do a lot of backups and restores and all the redundancies. So what if we would have some kind of material that will help you last all this data forever? So good news, we can use DNA. DNA is material that lasts for thousands of years. And we actually did already an experiment with Microsoft. So what we did, we took a video clip and we encoded the stream bytes, the ones and zeros, into A, T, G, and C, and then we synthesize it, and we put it in a special oven to simulate 10,000 years. We waited. After a while, we took it out, we read the DNA, sequenced it, and then decode back from ones and zero to A, T, G, and C, formatted as before, put it in the computer, click play, and it ran 100% accuracy. So that basically proved the technology, that this technology is viable and real. And there is one small thing. DNA is not only robust and lasts forever, it's also so small. What small? So the analysis is if you take petabyte of digital information, petabyte, 1,000 terabyte, and you synthesize this on DNA, all you need in terms of DNA material is one grain of salt, gargir melach, just one. And if you take the entire internet and put it on DNA, all you need is a DNA the size of a shoebox. So there is a revolution here as well. And with that, we have lots of examples. And I want to invite you all to come to our booth, hear more stories, and see more examples. All the team here with the iCodeLife t-shirt, they're all software engineers. We write most of our backend in Python, so it's all relevant. And one other thing, we do have a code challenge. So don't miss this opportunity. I know that you will do it for fun, but we also have prizes. So first place get a drone, second place get Bose headset. So try it out and enjoy the rest of the conference, and thank you very much. We actually have 4 minutes for questions. Yep.
So we have four letters in the DNA. Isn't it also a compression improvement, a combining code, one and zero?
You ask about compression because, yeah. So she asked, so in DNA we have four letters, A, T, G, and C. Binary is also only ones and zeros, so do we have a place for compression? So when I talked about the data storage, and I said encoding from ones and zero to A, T, G, and C, it can be really simple, like 0, 0 is A, 0, 1, et cetera, but actually the reality is much more compressed and efficient. So, yeah.
Yeah. Hi, how do you do encryption in DNA?
Encrypt in what way? The data storage or encrypt the genes? So for data storage, basically you have an algorithm. The algorithm, we're now working on commercializing the technology. But one option is to have the algorithm of encoding encrypted by the customer. This is one option, for example. So he's asking about the encryption in data storage. So basically the idea is to take the binary code that provided by the customer and store it in a DNA form so it will last forever. Now encryption is done by the customer, okay? And we don't, so just to make clear, we don't put it in living organism, we don't put it in cells, we just keep it in vials so it is robust. Many questions, yeah. How do we make the DNA? Great question, come to our booth. We have some videos and stuff to show you. So you're asking about CRISPR, one of the slides that I showed before. This is changing the DNA in real time. So just to make a small recap. So this CRISPR is an enzyme that you can actually program it. It's the first time, by the way, in history that we have the technology to change any location and the index in the genome. Up until now, to change genomes, what's called genome editing, you are limited only to certain locations, which has, it's called restriction sites, and specific scissors called restriction enzymes would come and change it. CRISPR is the first time that we can actually program it, give it a specific index, and it can change any index in our 6 billion letters of code genome. It's the first time, and this technology actually opened the door for all these genetic diseases fixing. And there are companies today, we are still in research phase, it's not FDA approval yet, but there are companies working on fixing specific types of cancer, fixing specific diseases like Alzheimer, and we have at least 3 companies worth of more than $1 billion each traded, publicly traded companies, and they are pre-FDA. This CRISPR is already used in plants, okay? Started trials in animals, but not yet on human. So it's few years ahead, okay? I don't know if it's gonna be 5 or 10 or more, but it's clear that the technology is there and just a matter of time until it's commercialized, okay? You have time? No. Okay, so guys, thank you very much. And for more questions, come to the booth.